But it was Thanksgiving Day, and a lady died in her bed. What basically happened is she was a real little lady, and somebody who was confused came into her room and got in her bed and kind of wiggled around and pushed her, rolled her over on her side, and got her wedged in between, her head wedged in between the side rail and the mattress. And Thanksgiving Day, maybe 4 or 5 years ago, she basically died, you know? And so a lot of places are basically getting rid of side rails, they're going to other things, half rails or a post to pull on. So if the nursing home is using any restraints at all anymore, it is very rare, and they have got to have it documented to why they're using it. You know, it's just like Foley catheters. Now, when I say a Foley catheter, you probably know what I mean, right? Okay? We used to use Foley catheters on everybody. We, you know, somebody comes to the hospital, first thing, man, put a Foley catheter in them. You know why? To get them up and take them to the bathroom. Hey, less work, you know? What we were doing was giving people urinary tract infections, you know? And it was a convenience item. So there's a bunch of stuff that, you know, is the whole mindset is basically changing. Just like I said about the hotel thing, you know? You look at a nursing home being built today, there's more private rooms in that nursing home than there have ever been before. Because the consumers are saying, I want my privacy. You know, I don't want to be in a room with a total stranger and stuff like that. Okay, so false imprisonment. We cannot just send a resident to their room. Put them in it. If they're being loud, put it in it, close the door, and leave them. If the resident's in a room, there had better be a staff member in there with them. So isolation or whatever, you know. Can't treat them like a prisoner of war, you know, and in times past, that's exactly what has happened, you know. And like I said, it kind of was, everybody was doing it the same way. It wasn't like one nursing home, it was kind of like the standard. That was thought to be the best thing, just send them in there, let them calm down, quiet down by themselves. But it's false imprisonment, it's involuntary seclusion. And that is basically abuse. Now, we have to be extremely careful about talking about anything about the residents, like HIPAA, the Health Insurance Portability and Accountability Act, privacy, confidentiality. We cannot give out information. This is a small community. You know, people are going to see you going into the nursing home. And they may come to you and say, hey, I saw you were doing your clinical over there. Hey, tell me about Joe. He's my best friend. He went for the doctor for a chest x-ray yesterday. He's been coughing real bad. Did they find out he's got lung cancer or not? You probably will know the answer to that. You can't say a word. You cannot say, yeah, he's got lung cancer. You know, would you like anybody getting a hold of your bank records and looking at them? Probably not, right? Well, it's the same thing with health records. We've got to protect them. It's called PHI, Protected Health Information. We cannot be giving it out. HIPAA is a major deal today. We used to, somebody call in, you know, hey, how's Mary Ann doing? And we tell them everything. Well, she had surgery. They took a cyst out of her. It weighed about so many grams. It was this wide in centimeters and this deep. They tested it for cancer, and it came back. You know, we used to tell everything, you know. But anymore, it's just gone to the opposite. It's part of safety and protection. So you're not only protecting them physically from hurting themselves, you're protecting their information from getting out. Invasion of privacy. This is simply walking into the room without knocking and asking permission to come in. You know, if you're at home tonight studying really hard, everybody's nodding their head, right? Nod your head like this, okay? And somebody walks in your house, you know, what are you gonna do? You know, some may reach for the phone, some may reach for the baseball bat, you know? Who just came in here? This is scary. It's the same thing in the nursing home. People are scared when they come into the nursing home. Have any of you been in the military? Okay. How about anybody been to a really large university? Okay. What was your first day like? Was it wonderful, or were you thinking, I made a mistake, I want to go home? It was scary. You were out of your comfort zone. Your friends, where are they? New sounds and new smells and new sights and too much newness. And you're going, you know, that's when most college students, you know, unless they were running away from home, you know, but most of them think, you know, oh, gosh, this is scary. And it is, because everything's new. Well, here comes a person into the nursing home, and my goodness, they watched that 2020 or Dateline program that I told you about 5, 6, 7 years ago. And that's still fresh in my mind. You know, when we watched this one film in a couple days, Bathing Without a Battle, you're gonna see a bald guy getting a shampoo. And what they do is they take a basin of water and they pour it over his head. And what the guy, and I'm kind of giving away the movie right now a little bit, but it's okay. What the guy does is go, oh, really loud like that. Okay, here's a new resident in the nursing home. They watch this TV program. They think, man, all these people, they're gonna hit me. They're going to come get me. And all of a sudden, at 8 o'clock at night, he hears, oh, he goes, they're coming for me next, you know? And they're scared. If you work the 3-11 shift or the 11-7 shift, expect to be tested. And what I mean by this is this, what I mean by that. You're gonna be in doing their HS cares, helping them brush their teeth, giving them their back rub, you know, getting them ready to go to bed. Okay, here's your call light. Now, you have a good night's sleep. If you need me, push your call light and I'll come down. Okay, you just gave them a promise, right? Okay, that's about 8 o'clock. 8:30, it's all quiet. 9 o'clock, oh man, this is kind of scary. I don't hear anything out there. Am I all by myself? So what does he do? Pushes the call light. You come down, yes, can I help you? Oh, did I push my call light? I'm sorry. Okay, no problem. You must have laid on it. 10 o'clock, oh gosh. What he does, pushes his brother, can I help you? Oh, did I push my call out again? I'm sorry. They were testing you. They were scared. They wanted to know they weren't the only person left on the planet. And because it is, it's scary, like that first day of college, you know, and they were simply testing you. You said, push your call light, I'll come. Okay, I'm going to find out. Will she really come? Will he really come? Or am I all by myself? So it is scary, you know, and they come in with preconceived ideas to the nursing home, and you know, and we all come with preconceived ideas. You know, you may have talked to past students and heard something that the tests that I give are extremely easy. You know, that's a preconceived idea. They're not. They're terribly hard. You know, not really. But anyways, I got quiet. You have talked to some past students, haven't you? That's wise. But the residents are going to be scared. They're going to test you. So living will, we already talked about that. Malpractice, mandated reporter, we talked about that. You are a protector of the innocent, you know. And here again, back to our circle, I'm not calling the elderly children, but I think you see my point. You know, the ending of life is much like the beginning of life, and they need as much help as an infant, as a 1, 2, 3, 4-year-old. And when they're in there with everything, physical needs and all the needs, basically helping them. the National Nurse Aid Training Competency Evaluation Program as part of OBRA. What this is they set down all the rules, all the training for you guys. You know, when Kansas makes up these 90 hours that you gotta have, all these certain units that you gotta have, all these hours that are here in this column, and this column, and how they all, you know, those things are written in stone. That's why if you miss any time, you gotta come in on Friday. If you're gonna miss a clinical, you gotta switch with somebody, get to one of the other clinicals. Because when we're all done, if you're missing any hours in class, missing any time in clinical, you know. Now, I'm not gonna scream and jump up and down if you gotta leave 5 or 10 minutes early for clinical, you know. But, you know, if you're missing like a half a day or something like that, clinical missing a day, we gotta find a replacement for that. And until we do, you haven't finished the class. Negligence, we've already talked about. Ombudsman. An ombudsman is not a state surveyor. They're a volunteer. But what they're coming in is to basically, several different reasons, to be friends with the residents, socialization, to basically visit with them, but also make sure everything's right. You know, a resident can give a complaint to an ombudsman and basically know, feel, and believe that the ombudsman's going to turn it into the DON or administrator and not tell them who said it to protect them. So like if there's a particular nurse aide that's being cruel, you know, the ombudsman will find out from the resident who it was. You know, well, now cruel was too far because that's got to be taken care of immediately. Let's just say a little bit rough, or something like that. No, that's even too far. Something that's not a major issue, something minor, I just can't think of something right now. Well, the ombudsman will go to the administrator and say one of your staff members, won't even say nursing, won't say what hall, won't say what shift, because want to protect the resident, you know, from any type of repercussion, so they will say, one of your residents said to me that one of your staff members just wasn't doing a good bath. They did an adequate bath, but it wasn't really good, you know? So what the administrator can do is, and at that point you know it's nursing, you know, because maintenance and others don't give baths. But they'll give an all staff in service because they don't know who it was. So the resident stays protected, but the information gets out there that, hey, somebody's reported that we're not given really good baths here. And a lot of the baths are very looked at in a positive way from the residents, because during the bath is when they feel better, you know, especially if they get a whirlpool bath. A lot of them, you know, it just helps their arthritis, and it just helps them feel better. Passive neglect, physical abuse, we talked about that, protective health information. Resident council, every nursing home will have a group of residents that meet on a scheduled basis, and it's kind of like you're like a board of directors, and they can basically propose to the nursing home things that they want to see the nursing home change. Most of the time it deals with dietary. Like, we're tired of having hamburgers 5 nights a week. But they literally can propose to the nursing home changes in things that they would like to see. And it's made up of the residents. The residents' rights are just that. They are rights that are identified by OBRA that the resident has particular rights in the nursing home. A couple of my favorite is they have the right to know, they have the right to decide, and they have the right to refuse. And these are rights that the people have. Sexual abuse, harassment, substance abuse, verbal abuse, that you can read about, workplace violence. So when we talk about ethics, laws, etiquette, you know, yeah, we are under laws. You know, if a staff member hits a resident, state will come, Surveyors will come, they'll investigate it, and the surveyors, if they believe it needs to be, they'll turn it over to the Attorney General's Office of Kansas to basically file criminal proceedings. So, you know, this is how serious that it has to be taken if a resident is being physically hurt by somebody, physically, verbally abused. Professional and ethical behavior, we talked about that already a little bit. Keep the resident's information confidential. Staff, you know, make sure that that's happening. Be honest at all times. Trustworthy, don't accept tips, report abuse or suspected abuse. Do not report to work under the influence of drugs or alcohol. You know, do your assigned task, be positive, professional, tactful. Treat all the residents with respect, and then of course be patient. You will find out that you have to be extremely patient. You're gonna be called on to be extremely patient because, you know, like if I'm the resident here and you're putting on my shirt and I've got some contractures and you finally work and you finally get it on. And it's very difficult to slip on over my head and my hands, and you finally get it on, and then all of a sudden I spit up, vomit, burp, or cough, whatever, and whoop, down the front. You gotta change it, you know, and you're going, son of a gun, you know, take it off, put a new one back on. Well, you got it. That's where your patience gets tested, you know. So that's where we gotta be patient. Describe the nurse assistant code of ethics. Here again, like I said, in these red highlighted things, put the word what is or what are. And that will focus you in on it, I think, a little bit better. What is the nursing assistant? Well, I will strive to provide, maintain the highest quality of care. I will communicate well, serve, you know, with commitment. I will learn, I will show positive attitude. I will practice privacy, I will be trustworthy. I will strive to preserve resident safety. I will have empathy for my residents. I respect all people. I will never abuse my residents. I will strive the utmost to have patients in my facility. You know, and like I said, it is a little bit superhuman. I mean, really, but that's what we do. That's who we are. You know, we are not, you know, quick-tempered. We can hold and control our temper. You know, we are, that is our attitude. And that's where I kind of say to you, I'm not making any of you nurses. You know, education, training, skills, yeah. But the nurse spirit, the nurse attitude, you've had for years. You know, all I'm doing is you know, giving the skills, increasing the skills in education. The Ombudsman Act, you can basically read about that. Resident rights, go ahead and read about these. For the quality of life and the services, the right to be fully informed, the right to participate in their own care, the right to have independent choices, and there's more resident rights, and the right to know, the right to decide, the right to refuse. That's probably why, of all the different areas that are open to nurses, probably one of my favorite is home health. Because the resident rights are probably followed the best in home health. Because, you know, I'm in that person's home. And if they don't like what I'm doing or saying, they can kick me out, you know. And I have to totally abide by what they say. Now, that should be true everywhere else, hospital, nursing home alike. But in the home, it really is. The patient, the resident in the home is truly the boss. They are truly in charge. And I think probably that's why the reason I do like home health, you know, now. I used to like trauma the best, but now home health, because, you know, I can really appreciate that type of control that the patients have and their rights. Abuse and neglect, we've already talked about that. Abuse can be physical, it can be verbal. Neglect is simply not doing what you're supposed to do. And then, of course, exploitation, like I said, is literally using them. Now, if you ever become, and you go on like nursing school or become a certified medication aide, you know, we talked about restraints, physical restraints. When you get to that level, you're going to learn about chemical restraints. Because sometimes we may not tie somebody down, but we'll drug them down, basically to OMH, get them out of my hair. You know, if they're being a little bit rambunctious or loud or restless or whatever, pop them a pill, make them go to sleep, you know. Instead of thinking about other alternatives, what we can do. Why are they restless? What's the problem? You know, we had one lady that she could not sleep at night. They're coming to get me. Somebody's out my door. They're coming to get me. You know, and it drove the staff nutso on the night shift. Well, for some reason, I had to go up there one night, and it's just a matter of being in the right place at the right time. It's not that I was any better than the other nurses. It's just I was at the right place at the right time. I was in her room, and there was a branch in the tree when the wind blew, came and blew and tapped on her window. And she said, "See, they're there. They're there. They're coming to get me. They're out there, you know." So what did we do? And I got the saw and took the branch off. You know, and she was fine. You know, so we've got to find out why are they restless, why are they anxious, just like we've got to find out why they're in pain, why are they crying, why. Sometimes you're going to feel a little bit like a cop, you know, like you're investigating here, trying to find out why and then the what's behind it. Learn to recognize abuse and neglect. Now, recognizing neglect is easy. You know, the face isn't washed, they haven't shaved, the hair is still matted. It hasn't been shampooed. Now, abuse might not be so obvious. One of the things that just happened to our daughter, like last week, and because, you know, like I said, she lived around us, so there's a lot of things she knows, and she was going to see one of her girlfriends, and as she was, and the girlfriend was sitting in a chair like this, and Heather was walking around her like this, and going to sit over there, like right about where you're at. And as she walked around, the girl did this. Well, Heather walked around, she sat down immediately, she named her boyfriend and goes, "He's hitting you, isn't he?" And she had picked up that this right here, this flinch, this was like a block, you know. And you walk around the resident and they do something like that. Maybe the night before, they were blocking slaps or something like that. So sometimes the signs are really subtle. Big bruise right here, big fingerprint marks, and you look at it, and my gosh, that's the print of somebody's hand, a big hand. Broken glasses, broken teeth, bruises.